Today I want to talk about failure. Failure is universal. Everybody fails. A baby is born, tries to walk, it falls, gets up again. Even people who are born with a silver spoon in their mouth will fail, because everybody fails. But the issue is that failure is the place where success begins. And we can see that when we look into the book of Exodus, because it's everywhere in Exodus. When we think about successful people, we think of certain names, like, for instance, Beethoven. Beethoven was one of the great composers of our time. But his music teacher told him, as a composer, you're hopeless. But he took hopeless and turned it into success. We think of Walt Disney. Walt Disney, who is the man of imagination. He was fired from his job because the boss said, you lack imagination. He took it from failure to success, because success begins where failure starts. And Henry Ford forgot to put a reverse gear in the first car he built. In fact, the bank manager told his lawyer, don't invest in cars. And then he said, because the horse is here to stay. Some people don't realize that success sometimes actually looks like failure at the time. But when we deal with Moses, and we're going to be dealing with Moses, Moses had a special niche. He was actually born a failure, because he was born the wrong sex. He was born a male, and Pharaoh had decreed that every Hebrew male infant be killed, thrown into the Nile River, and destroyed. So he was born the wrong sex. He was also born at the wrong time. He was born a failure. But God takes hopeless things, and in this case, God turned the tables on Pharaoh, who wanted Moses killed, and used Pharaoh and his daughter to rescue Moses, who was in a basket in the Nile. And then Pharaoh paid all of his expenses to teach him, to clothe him, to do whatever Moses wanted. He was now a prince, and whatever Moses wanted, Moses got. He had a chariot, and he had a chariot driver. He could go anywhere he wants, and I'm sure he took a couple of cruises up the Nile, bought a condo, and all his bills were paid. What a difference. He's born a failure. God does something and makes Pharaoh foot the bill to make him a prince. So we see the first success that God actually produced in Moses' life. He becomes the prince. He goes from rags to riches, like that. Only God could do things like that. And you know, in a sense, God has actually done that with us. We were born in sin, and the Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So God took us from a hopeless situation and set us to sit in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. So God's already done that to us. Now, this is what we read in the life of Moses. When Moses was 40 years old, now he's been a prince for 40 years. When he was 40 years old, the Bible says Moses went out to his brethren and saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his brethren. He knew he was Hebrew, because at the very beginning his mother taught him who he was. So this is what we read. He looked this way and that way, and when he saw no one, he killed the Egyptian. and hid him in the sand. He thought he could start a revolution. The very next day, when he went out, the second day, behold, two Hebrew men were fighting. And he said to the one who did the wrong, "Why are you striking your companion?" And he said, "Who made you a prince and a judge over me? Do you intend to kill me as you killed the Egyptian?" Moses thought nobody was looking, but somebody was looking, because they realized that he had killed the Egyptian. And now Moses is worried, because as soon as Pharaoh finds out, Pharaoh is coming after Moses to kill him. So Moses flees. This is the story where he fails, and success begins at the point of failure, and he flees into the wilderness. And it says that he came to sit down by a well. It's the picture. And a lot of times you find in scripture pictures. There are a lot of pictures in the Bible. This is the picture of a man who is destitute, who has failed, who is exhausted and defeated, sitting by a well. While he was sitting there by the well, he felt like a failure. I want to pause for a moment to tell you something about Casey Stengel. Casey Stengel, we know him as the great New York manager. But his first job was to manage a team in Boston. And he failed so badly that they fired him. So then he managed the team in Brooklyn. And not only did he fail, but his boss, the owner, said, "You are an amateur," and actually paid him a year's wages not to manage the team. That give you some idea how he failed? But then we know he went on to become the manager of the Yankees, and he made an incredible name for himself. And when he retired, he was honored at a farewell dinner. And this is what he said. "A professional is an amateur who gets back up." That happens to be the message of the Bible. We get back up. We go down, we get back up. There are only two choices: either get back up or stay down. People who stay down live the rest of their lives in depression. So this is what we find. Moses is sitting down by a well, and he's feeling really bad. And when he's there, the daughters of Jethro come out to feed their flocks. They were little shepherdesses, and they were going to bring their flock to the well. And Moses watches. While he is watching them, he notices that there are some shepherds who harass Jethro's daughters and try to keep them from watering their sheep. Moses stood up. It's the beginning. He was sitting at the well in defeat, and now he stood up. And I want you to notice something about him standing up. When he stood up, this is what had to go through his mind. He had to say something like this: "I got in this mess because I tried to handle an injustice in Egypt. I killed a man. And then when I tried to handle another injustice, they blamed me for killing the man. I had to run away. I think I'm going to sit this one out because I don't want to. I've been there. I've done that. I do not want to get involved." But he stood up. He stood up. That's the first issue that a person who has failed needs to do. Stand up and face the problem. So he stood up. Now, we are not told what he said to those shepherds who were harassing the shepherd girls. But in the research that I do, I find things that no other people can find. This is what I think Moses would have said to those men. "Okay, wiser guys, I'm telling you something. You break You broke the first commandment, which is ladies first. Who do you think you are? If you want to see tomorrow, you better leave today. If you're looking for trouble, you found it. You see this rod I have in my hand? It's a .357 Magnum. If I hit you, you know, get up. So I'm going to count to 10. And when I get to 5, I want to see your footprints in the sand going away. If not, I will bury you where you stand. Gabesh. I think that's what he said. But what I came to tell you is what happens in the 21st verse of Exodus 2. Then Moses was content. Content. This is a special word when it comes to somebody who has failed and they finally realize they need to face up to whatever the problem was. In this case, it was injustice. Then Moses was content to live with Jethro, and Jethro gave Zipporah, his daughter, to Moses. What the story tells us is that we need to learn how to add up the pluses in our lives, because so often our focus is in on the negatives. So we start adding the negatives up because this went wrong, that went wrong, the other thing went wrong, and we hear all of these things, these voices, these dreary voices in our mind. But we need to learn how, like Moses, to add up the pluses. What are the pluses? Number one, he had a job, being a shepherd. But the Egyptians despised the occupation of a shepherd. So Moses had to face up and had to confront the problem of being a shepherd, which was despised by the Egyptians. Two, he lived with Jethro. He married his daughter. And although Moses did not know this, Moses did not know that being a shepherd simply meant he was on the job training. And that the day would come when he would be the shepherd of 2.5 million sheep, the children of Israel. Scripture tells us, Paul tells us this, he says, in whatsoever state you are in, therewith to be content. I think we have a problem with a scripture verse like this, because sometimes we think, well, you know, I'm in this mess. How can I be content in this mess? How can I be content? You can be content because you are in, it's a transition to something else. Yes, you failed. Yes, you're in a mess. Yes, there's a problem here and you're grappling with difficulties, but you are moving and you are moving out of that and you're moving into another transition and God's got something planned. So I'm going to learn how to be content in whatever state. What is the state? Because whatever state you happen to be in, you can be content. That's not easy to do. And as Janita mentioned, James said, count it all joy when you fall into divers trials and tribulations. He's basically saying the same thing. You can find contentment in whatever, because God is taking whatever we're in, and he's moving us from where it is to a place called patience, so we can find contentment. I was looking through the scripture, and I came to Deuteronomy, the 8th chapter, the 2nd verse. And this is what Moses actually tells the people at the end of his life. He's about ready to go meet the Lord, and this is what he says. How long, he didn't say this, but the question comes in my mind, how long do I have to be content, Pastor Joe? And this is what Moses said. Moses said, you shall remember that the Lord led you all the way these, how many years? 40 years in the wilderness to humble you and test you. Moses is telling the people what he learned himself He was in that wilderness for 40 years, had no idea where it was leading him, but he finally figured out at the end that where it is leading you, it is leading you to a place called humility, and it's a test. So he's giving the people advance notice. This is what's going on in your life. Even though nobody told him what was going on in his life, and so he wrote it in Deuteronomy 8, 2, so that we could have it, so that we could understand something about the waiting period that we find ourselves in. Isn't it amazing that God may be using a waiting period to humble us and to test? Could it be that what you're going through right now, what we are going through right this moment, is all part of a test? It's all part of what God is doing in a person's life, because we think that you can become humble in a week. God thought it took 40 years for Moses. Now, it's not going to take that long for you and me, I hope. I don't have 40. But God uses time to teach us things like humility. Not because God can't do it. It's because we won't. So it took God 40 years to teach Moses to be. But you know, the Bible says that Moses was the meekest man on earth. I look at that and I think, here's what I think. Let me digress for a moment. I think here's the man who's called the meekest man on the earth. But he got so angry one day, he struck a rock when God told him to speak to it. He may have been the meekest man on the earth, but he was not the meekest man as far as God is concerned. He still needed some help. We still need some work done in our lives to make us meek and humble. And God's in the process, in what we're going through, whatever it is we're going through, God is using it. It's the place where God humbles us and tests us. When you think of Moses, you think of a man. Here's a man who became the greatest man in the Old Testament. Moses is there. You know, by the time you get to the New Testament, if you spoke about Moses in a negative way, people would stone you. But do you want to know something? Moses was not great until after he died. Because while he was leading those people through the wilderness, they were picking up stones to try to stone him. They hated him. They rebelled against him. And they mumbled and grumbled and complained all the way to the promised land. That's not considered great to me. But it wasn't until after he died that the thought occurred to me. Can we be content even if our greatness is not known until after we die? That's a tough issue. But that's what Moses did. If you read the story as we go through the book of Exodus, you will find that Moses has got one problem after another. And at one point, he just wanted to quit. But God took him and made him the man that he would become even after he died. You know, the issue in Scripture is this: through it all, through whatever we're going through, and we go through a lot of stuff, through it all, he learned to depend on God's word. And now when Andre Crouch wrote this, through it all, I learned to depend on God's word. We think in terms, well, I learned to depend because I was reading God's word. Oh, and it's only part of the story. This is how Moses learned to depend on the word of God. It was through experiences, through defeats, through setbacks, through slam dunks, through the irritation and the anger of people, that he learned to depend. It's through the experiences that we're going through right now that we learn to depend on the Lord. That's reality. It's not through a great sermon. It's the experiences That's how we learn to depend on the Lord. And if you read through the scripture, you discover that there's so many people who were failures and became successful. Peter went out of his way to confess that he was willing to die for Jesus, and a few hours later he denied him three times. And that failure was the beginning of his success. Because on the day of Pentecost, he stood up and proclaimed the gospel. This is that which was spoken by Joel the prophet. In the last days, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. It took failure to jolt Peter to the reality of a promise he made. John Mark left Paul in the middle of a missionary campaign, quit, walked away. So bad that Paul did not want to use John Mark again. And yet, that failure catapulted John Mark to become the writer of the Gospel of Mark. And later Paul would say, bring Mark because I need him. It's failure. It's the place where we fail. And it's the experiences that we experience while we're transitioning to the promises that help us get to the promised land. Look at this. You got God who's going to take care of you. We sing that song so many times. They experienced the pillar of cloud by day, the pillar of fire by night. They experienced the stone being struck and spoken to, and water came out of the rocks. They experienced manna coming down from heaven. They experienced that when they ran into an enemy, God was with them to overcome. That's what happens when we're going through our wilderness. There are things that are actually happening to us while we're going through the stressful time, while we're going through the trial, while we're going through the test, that we will look back and we say, yeah, God, I saw God. I saw God send the manna when I needed the manna. We were hungry and the manna came. When we were thirsty, he sent the water. God meets our needs. That's why we sing, God will take care of me. We got to make it personal. So Moses went from failure to a place of success because that's where God used him. And I want us to sing, I'd like to open up this altar, sing a song we've sung before. God does all of that so that we can discover he loves us and we love him back. This altar is open.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.